Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you. Good to see you again. It's a beautiful morning, even with the rain, right? Because we need rain too. Yeah. All right. I got several announcements, so be patient with me as we go through them. I first want to bring up our Hoyt and Ann Jones. I want to talk about them for a moment. We're praying for their family, praying for you guys. Hoyt went home on Thursday. It's a good time of celebration and also sadness. It's a mixture. So just praying for their family. And Ann has been in the hospital and rehab for weeks, few weeks. And so they haven't been able to be together. And so, but just praying for their family. And we know where Hoyt is. It's a good day for him, for sure. Also, getting into some other announcements. We had Sunday school fellowship time last night. I mentioned it last week. It started off with our Sunday school class, how we were talking about we didn't know each other as well as we'd like to, so we got together for a fellowship time. We invited everybody. We had some of you that are not in my class show up too last night. It was great. We even wrestled on the floor. You need to be there to know the context. But it was a lot of fun, and we did get to know each other better. And we're going to continue to do things like that, maybe monthly. So wrestling, Kurt, me and you, next time, all right? Me and you. Next month, it's sort of a fellowship time. We have an event. My Sunday school class is working through the Sermon on the Mount and the Beatitudes, and we are on Blessed Are the Persecuted. And so God gave us this event. It's a live streaming event with several speakers about persecution that's happening right now in Iraq. And so this is happening on March 8th. And so we're going to couple this with our next fellowship time together, just because the timing is about a month away. So mark your calendars, March 8th. I'll keep telling you more about this as it gets closer. Also, youth ministry tonight. We've been having a good time. Please be in prayer for that. If you've been helping with that, thank you very much. It's been an awesome time. God is moving wonderfully. We have a special guest speaker tonight. It's exciting. And so come out if you feel led to come out and be a part of it. Otherwise, pray about our youth ministry. Also, the Go-Getters. We got stuff going on from all ages. The Go-Getters are going out this Friday to Smoke on the Water restaurant in Greenville. There's a sign-up sheet in the vestibule. If you're not sure, between now and Friday, you don't get to sign up, contact Miss Annette about going. And that's leaving here at 10:30. So they try to take the bus, the church van down, or wherever they're going, and have lunch together. And that's a good time. Also, I have a note that from the last service. Jenny, do you want to make an announcement? Somebody else. All right. Evelyn. And Melissa. Give her the mic.
Oh, thanks. All right. We are heading up for the Operation Christmas Child Shoebox. We want to start a craft club. So it is March 12th from 6:30 to 7:30. And anybody that wants to come, please come. Please join us. Evelyn has great patterns and stuff.
This is one thing that we've had made and are making. If you sew, we're interested in that. If you have any fabric, thread, yarn, needles of any kind, crochet, knitting, that you don't use and you'd like to donate, we'll take those to share with ladies that want to participate. I have a few things that we've actually made, and I'll pass out patterns if you want them. But we want every kid to have a ball or something to go in those shoe boxes. So if you're interested, I have other things that I've made that, like I said, I can pass out patterns for everybody, anybody. On our craft night, we won't just be crocheting. We will be putting together fishing kits, Sewing kits, anything that we could put in those shoe boxes. We want to get the church fully involved in this and see this program grow.
And our goal this year is 750 shoe boxes? Oh, we are doing over 900. So everybody needs to get involved. And we'll keep you updated as we go along with this.
And we will be passing out every 2 months, 3 months, we will be collecting items for the shoe boxes where you can go buy stuff and bring it in. So there'll be lots of opportunities to help. Yeah. So.
All right. It's exciting. Now I know to bring stuff to throw when I'm doing announcements. That's good, good, good. Bo has something he wants to share with us too. I'll meet you halfway.
Man, I got to follow that. I don't have anything to throw out or anything. Well, I got set up for that one, didn't I? I'm Bo Caldwell, and I attend the first service, and this is a much younger group than I noticeably see filling these pews up. But the women do a tremendous job here with women's groups and other things, and now I feel like it's time for the men to step up. So we're going to have a little men's retreat. I'd like for you to pray about it, and if you'd like to go. It's up there on the screen. It's June 14th and 15th. And it will be in Huntsville, Alabama. That's such a neat way to say it, isn't it? But it's if you can see the leaders, look at that, on who will be speaking to us. We'll leave here on Friday morning. We will drive. It starts at 7 o'clock Friday evening, and we'll spend one night, and it goes from 7 to 10 that night, and then in the morning we'll get up, and it goes from 8 to 12. On Saturday, and then we'll drive back Saturday night. So you'll be back in time for church on Sunday. Pray about it. If you're interested in going, I made this announcement for the first. I think it'd be great for just men fellowship. This is what this is for. It is a men's conference. And like I said, there's several people I've heard speak up there, and there's several people that I haven't that I'm looking forward to hearing. So Todd, everyone knows Todd. All right, Todd and I talked about it, and Todd says, let's go. So Todd and I are going. Now, Todd and I will go by ourselves, or Todd and I will get a group together. What I would like for you to do is, if you're interested, I'm always here most of the time on Wednesday nights. I'll be here on Sunday mornings. Todd here's in the second service, but we just need a list together so we can make motel reservations so we're all kind of staying in the motel together. If you're interested, if you want to know more about it, you can go, like I said, to Gridiron Men's Conference in Huntsville, Alabama. So, all right, thank you.
Exciting stuff going on at our church, yeah, for sure. I missed this in the first service. Adam and Shelby Sitton, we are collecting diapers for them. So that's what they said they mainly needed was diapers. Here's a little write-up, awesome picture of Everett, who's been fighting and fighting and fighting since like October. Anybody remember dates? Help me out. October 8th, thank you. See, I'm a general. I need my wife for the details. Oh, I don't have time to read that. I got all this to read, too. So, yeah, October 8th. Thank you. So we are collecting some diapers for him. That's mainly what he needs. Take them to the fire department by Wednesday. So this Wednesday, and sizes 2 and up. Thank you. All right. Online giving, shift into that. Online giving is back. We've been without it for about 6 months or so. The service we were using before shut down. We've been evaluating some others. It's back online. It's a different service. Some of you guys are aware of this Church Center app that's been kind of being built quietly in the background, but the giving part is fully functional. If you want to do online giving to our church, here it is. It's a good way. And if you have any questions, you can ask me. You can ask Stephanie, my Stephanie, and we can help you out with that. And last but not least on the announcements, we have heard this week that Danny and Judy Justice, or rather it was Judy and Danny was the way it was announced, Juju, they got Apple Growers of the Year by the Blue Ridge Apple Growers Association. So It's an awesome feat for our... Yeah, for sure. All right, let's turn to our prayer list. We have several folks on our prayer list. I'm going to name quite a few. Hoyt and Ann were praying for their family. As we said, praying for Ann, praying for Mike Verbal. We're praying for the John Dalton family, praying for Mariah McLeod. That's Hugh's daughter. She's in an accident. She's getting better, but she's got quite a lot of things to heal from her car accident. We're praying for Louise Sheehan. I lost my place. Earl's mom, praying for her. Praying for Miss Janice. Carol, brother, praying for you guys. Praying for Ann Fowler. I understand she, and I didn't grow up here, so she's a teacher, was a teacher, retired teacher that most of y'all had in school at some point. She has fallen and broken her hip, so I've been asked to put her on our prayer request. Also, praying for our sister, Jackie Griffin, praying for her. She's doing better slowly. Please be in prayer for her and for Lowell. Praying for Miss Donna and your daddy, Gene Smith. And pray for our church. Our church, God is doing stuff here. Not, you know, he's active and moving, and it's exciting in many different places. And we're all going to go for an awesome ride if we let him take us. So pray for our church. Stand with me. I know we all have many unspoken requests. Stand with me and let's pray. Father God, we are just amazed to be able to bring, or just to be in your presence, for you to live inside of us, for you to save us, for us to be able to be yours through Jesus Christ. Let us not ever forget the simple, wonderful gift of his life that he gave for us so that we can have life with you again. Where that's why we're here. That's why we're here as his people, to fellowship with each other, to gather and celebrate you, to just worship you. You are beyond our imaginations and beyond our words and beyond our songs. But I pray that you just let us do our best as your people to worship you right now together collectively. And Lord, I pray for the many folks on our prayer list. Pray for the Jones family. Pray for just all the needs that we didn't even speak about. Many of us ourselves have needs. And Lord, we pray that we just know how faithful you are and how perfectly faithful you are, and everything that you have us going through as your children is for a reason. And let us just trust you and celebrate and rejoice. And again, rejoice for everything that's happened in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
You give life, you are love, you So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only.
unspeakable things you've done. Fix your eyes on the mountain, let the past be dead and gone. Come on, saints and sinners, you can't outrun God. Whatever you've done can't overcome the power of the blood.
If you're lost there, wandering, come stumbling in like a prodigal child. See the walls start crumbling, let the gates of glory open wide. If you're lost there, wrecked again, come stumbling in like a prodigal child. See the walls start crumbling, let the gates of glory open wide.
Amen. I have the best job in the world, but also have the hardest job because I have to follow them every Sunday, and that's not easy to do. Amen. If you love your praise team, give them a hand this morning. Yeah. Wednesday is a special day. It's the middle of the week. Hump day. This one's a little more special. Amen? Yeah. Gentlemen, y'all aware of what's going on Wednesday, right? I'm here to save somebody's life today. If you don't know what Wednesday is, raise your hand. If you're going, I don't know what's going on. Okay, it's Valentine's Day, gentlemen. Okay? Now, for about the last 23, 24 years, it's customary that on the Sunday before Valentine's Day, or if Valentine's Day falls on that particular Sunday, we give away some cookies. I got four of them to give away this morning. There was five. But there's an hour between services. No. So we're going to recognize two couples. And then we're just going to randomly give away two of these awesome cookies. Now here's the way this works. You and your spouse must both be in the service this morning. So if you came by yourself and like your anniversary comes up and he wasn't here with you, go home and whoop him. All right? You have the pastor's permission. I want to let's give away the first two cookies. I want to know the couple that's been married the longest, endured the most, and made it happen. I'm just kind of looking around the crowd here. I'm just kind of looking around who might have been married the longest. Oh, we got a couple over here. I don't know. Marvin, Linda, how long you been married? 52 years. All right, yeah, that's good. Can anyone beat that? 52 years. Now, I understand there's probably somebody's been here married long, but unfortunately, your spouse has to be with you. Anybody can beat 52 years. Okay. All right, now, I know, and I want to point them out, Carol, you and Janice, I know she can't be here today. How many years y'all been married? 57 years. Amen. Amen. In the first service, I said, who's been married the longest? Bill Barnwell said, and I'm quoting, 66 years, 11 months, and 8 days. He knew it, brother. Marvin, Linda, you get a cookie at the end of the service. Come up and get it. We want to take a picture for the Facebook page, if that's okay. So give them another hand. 52 years. Amen. Linda, that's a long time to put up with that man. There you are. All right. It's, huh? It was easy. Oh, amen. That's what my wife says. Yeah. It's been her pleasure. You know. All right. I'm one of the couple that's been married the least amount of time. I mean, I'm talking newlyweds here. Who's been married just a year or two, three or four? Four years. Still on your honeymoon. I hear you. I got 4 years right here with Big Al and Wendy. Anybody less than four? Ryan and Brittany. I did your wedding. I ought to know this. I'm sorry I don't. How long has it been? 2.5 years. Where is Seth and Kayla? Did they leave?
Seth and KK, they're upstairs. Seth went to go look at barbecue. Seth had to go fix the barbecue for you.
How long
he's coming back.
How long have you been married?
2 years.
Exactly?
No, December. So.
Two years and 2 months?
Yeah.
Okay, 2 years, 2 months. Anybody less than that? All right, Seth, Michaela, you get a cookie at the end of the service. All right. All right, now for this next one, I need some help. Joy, would you be my volunteer this morning and help me for a minute, please? Since you're so close. I'm going to go by anniversaries. Y'all going to have to help me do the math here. Okay? Give Miss Joanna a round of applause for helping me this morning. Okay. I want you to reach in there, Miss Joy, and grab us a month. Just grab one. Any of them. Okay? That is short for November. Do we have any November anniversaries? Anybody get married in November? Kathy has to be here, though. I'm sorry, brother. Anybody else? Anybody else? Now, see, now you can go home, Jackie, and say, let me have it. All right, pick another one, Joy. Pick another. January. Got a January? January 1st. I remember that. January, over here? January? Okay, all right, let's pick a number then. Reach down in there deep, Toyanna, and grab a number. We'll see who's the closest to this number. What's the number?
11.
That's your date. January 11th. You get a cookie. You get a cookie. All right, put the 11th back in there. Got one more cookie to give away. All right, Joy, grab another. April anniversaries. Stephanie and Brian. Any other April anniversaries? Donna and EO. All right, let me have that one. Let's see who's closest to this date. Whoever's the closest to
13.
Actually, it's the other way.
Oh, 31.
31st. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. 30. Brian gets a cookie today. There you go. Thank you, darling. I appreciate it. Give my lovely assistant another hand, please. Appreciate her. Yeah, at the end of the service, please come and get you a cookie. I do want to warn you, though, the lids don't stay on well. So if you don't want it in the floor, hold on tight. Okay? All right. Thank you for playing along. Appreciate that. And happy Valentine's Day to everyone here this morning. I want you to go to the book of Mark, Mark chapter 12. Mark chapter 12, verse 28. Mark chapter 12, verse 28. I'll be reading out of the King James Version. If you want to, if you brought something different, want to read along with me, there's a Bible in front of you in the pew that you can join in with us. Plus, Noah will be putting it up on the screen for us. Of course, it's February, the month that we celebrate the love we have for our Valentine's. So I'm preaching on the subject of love. And last week we talked about the greatest love of all. We looked at John 3:16, the love that God has for us. And we saw four things. We saw that God's love for us is unmerited. What that means, church, is we don't deserve God's love, but He loves us anyway. We also saw that God's love for us is unconditional. God loves us even when we don't love Him. He still loves us. Number three, we saw that God's love for us is unlimited. God is a forgiving God, a God of second chances. And fourthly, we saw that God's love for us is unescapable. Excuse me. Church, we can't stop the love of God because He is love. That's who God is. That's His character. That's His DNA. He is love. Folks, God really loves us. Can you say amen this morning? God really loves us. Well, this morning, I want to ask you this. Do you really love God? Excuse me. I am so sorry. Do you really love God? Okay. We're going to find out. We're going to go through a test this morning. And we're going to see if you and I really love God. In Mark chapter 12, verse 28, A scribe was a person back in Jesus' day who dedicated their life to studying the Hebrew law, the laws. And they had like 300 and something, I think it was like 312 laws. They took the Ten Commandments and added a whole bunch to it. And this particular scribe was trying to make a fool of Jesus, as they were apt to do, and asked Jesus a question. Listen to Jesus' answer. And one of the scribes came, and having heard them reasoning together, Jesus had already been putting up with the Pharisees and the scribes and all that, and perceiving that he had answered them well, asked him, he thought this is going to be a trick question for Jesus, he said, which is the first commandment, which is the greatest commandment of all? And Jesus answered him, the first or the greatest of all commandments is, hear, O Israel, the Lord God, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first or the greatest commandment. Jesus took all the rules and regulations that the Jewish people had, all these 312 rules of how to, you know, work with God and get along with God, and he reduced them to two. He said, love the Lord your God and love your neighbor as yourself. We might talk about that one next week. But I want to focus on verse 30. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and all thy soul and all thy mind and all thy strength. Now, let me ask my question again, since you've heard the scripture. Do you really love God? Do you really love God? Let's go through those one at a time. If you really love God, church, you will love Him with all your heart. With all your heart. Church, to love God with all your heart means that you have a fire, a passion, a craving, a yearning for Him. Lots of people come to church. Lots of Christians around the world say, I love God. But do you love God with all your heart? See, there's a difference. There's a difference between saying, I love God, and I love God with all that I am. I love Him with all my heart. I have a passion for Him. I have a craving for Him. See, too many of us Christians, we can come to church Sunday after Sunday, and an hour's enough. We're good. We don't need any more. If you love God with all your heart, you're going to want more and more and more of Him every day. Do you really love God? The psalmist wrote, as the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God. You ever been out on a hot day? A really hot day? And man, you're working, you're doing things. And all you want is a drink of water. You ever been there? That's the way we are to want God, desire Him. The psalmist continues, my soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When can I go and meet with God? See, somebody loves God with all their heart. Sunday morning's not enough. They want more. When can I get to God? When can I see more of God? When can I get more of God in my life? When you love God with all your heart, you desire God more than you desire anything else. Church, what's your greatest desire today? What's your greatest desire? Now, I'm preaching to you, but listen. If God is not your greatest desire, then you don't love Him with all your heart. Have you ever heard someone say something like this? I love them, but I'm not in love with them. You ever heard that before? There's a big difference between loving someone and being in love with them. And church, let me just be honest and straightforward this morning. Too many of us Christians are in that kind of relationship with God. We love Him, but we're not in love with Him. When you're in love with God, you will love Him with all your heart. And when you love Him with all your heart, you'll want to spend time with Him. You'll want what He wants. You'll love what He loves. You'll hate what He hates. You'll grieve over what grieves Him. You won't be able to get enough of Him. Is there anybody in here that can't get enough of God today? Do you really love God? He has to have all your heart. Number two, if you really love God, you will love Him with all your soul. All your soul. Pastor, what does that mean? To love God with all your soul means that you have an emotional love for Him. An emotional attachment. Folks, I see people come to church Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, and there's no emotion. It's like it's dead. People walk in these doors, and churches all around the world, they walk in, they fulfill their commitment. Yeah, I went to church today. I'm a good person. Let's check that off the box and leave. There is no emotion. I see people come to church every Sunday, and the songs are being sung and played, and people just stand there like that, like there's nothing happening. There's no emotion. Beloved, listen, if there's no emotion in your faith, then you need to question and make sure your faith is real. Is anybody hearing what I'm saying this morning? Emotional. That's loving God with all of your soul. What makes you emotional? Does anybody get emotional in here? Is it just me because I'm getting old? Emotional. I was thinking about that this week. I get emotional over lots of things. I get emotional when I see... Now, some of you may not be able to appreciate what I'm talking about here, but I get emotional when I see a veteran salute the American flag, man, that gets me. We were at a NASCAR race years ago, and they did one of the, I don't know if it was Air Force or who it was, Navy, but they did what they call a flyover. Man, that made me emotional. I think that means maybe I really love my country. I get emotional over my country. I get emotional when my sons and daughter-in-laws achieve milestones in their lives. I get emotional about that. When they graduate high school. Hey, let me back up. When they started kindergarten, I got emotional. Graduated high school, the tears flowed. They graduated college, they got married. I think that means I really love my children. I got emotional this week. Hoyt went to heaven. And man, I went out. And this ain't about me. But I was able to go out yesterday because, see, Hoyt's wife, Ann, she was in the hospital, in the nursing home. She couldn't even be there when her husband passed. Couldn't be by, yeah, it's sad. And I was standing by her bedside yesterday, and I just walked in, and the first thing, I couldn't say, hey, Ann, how are you, or nothing. I just walked in, Ann, I'm so sorry. And I got emotional. It caused Ann to get emotional. It's not specifically about Hoyt and Ann. I think it's because I love my church, family. It makes me, what makes you emotional? Well, and I'm just not talking just about tears. What gets you excited? What is it? Years ago, my boys did marching band. Okay? And we were at Inca High School. And they had all these bands. Evelyn, you with me, sister? They had all these bands, high schools coming. They were competing against each other. And they said, like, hey, we got a special treat for you. Like, cool. Okay? And, of course, I got emotional when North Henderson played. It was like, yeah, you know, my kids are out there. It's awesome. Well, they, you know, you're sitting in the stands, and they said, Western Carolina University is going to play. Anybody ever seen Western Carolina University band? A few of you? If you haven't, Google it. Go to YouTube and watch it. I was sitting there in the stands, and everybody knows who I am. I'm the pastor. But we're sitting in the stands at Inca High School. And Western Carolina University band comes out on the field. They're marching like 300 kids. They fill up the whole field. And man, they hit that first note. I stood up out there, yeah! Woo! I was. Tammy's like, sit down, man. I was emotional. It overwhelmed me. It was awesome. I think that means I like music. I really love music. Let me ask you again. What makes you emotional, church? What is it? Does God ever make you emotional? Have you ever had that time in church when the tears flowed? When your heart swelled and you were like, man, this is so incredible. If you've never had that, and you call yourself a Christian, I'm not here to judge you. I'm not here to question your faith. But if you've never experienced that, look in the mirror and see if you've really ever accepted Jesus Christ. Because, beloved, you cannot let Him come into your heart without getting emotional. You can't let Him take over your life without getting tore up. He's given you life abundant here and life eternal to come. How can you not get excited about that? How can you not get emotional about that, church? Again, I'm not here to judge. But I get worried about people who come to church Sunday after Sunday, year after year, and I see no emotion. There's no nothing. It's like they're just fulfilling their duty. Take a look at yourself. God is a God of emotions. He made you emotional. If you get more emotional watching a Hallmark film than you do thinking about your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, examine yourself. Amen? Church, when you love God with all of your soul, you're not ashamed to shed a tear in church when the Holy Spirit touches you or anywhere else. You're not embarrassed to worship Him. You're not too proud or sophisticated to give Him praise. I see that all the time, and I know I'm preaching to you, but I see people come to church and, man, the Holy Spirit's just moving, and people, yes, Lord, I love you, but you got somebody going, I'm good. I'm good. Man, your heart's cold. I don't mean you're a bad person. I just mean the Holy Spirit ain't touched it yet. Love God with all your soul. Let me ask my question again. Do you really love God? Do you really love God with all your soul? Number three, if you really love God, you'll love Him with all your mind. You'll love Him with all your mind. Does anybody recognize this guy? That's not Kurt Thomas, no. That's the real one. Who is that? All right, now I realize I got people back in this section right here who are probably going, I don't know who that is, preacher. Allie, you know who Elvis is? Briley, Elvis, you got it. Dylan, do you know who Elvis is? He's got the dance down. Now, I'm going somewhere with this. And now, no disrespect intended, okay? No disrespect intended. How many of you were Elvis fans? Okay, yeah. Now, see, in the first service, every hand went up. Little bit older crowd, okay? But, no disrespect intended, but when Elvis died in 1977... I was just a kid. I was just a kid. And so to me, Elvis Presley was just a famous fat guy in a jumpsuit. Okay. Now again, no disrespect intended. But that's who he was to me. He was just a fat guy, you know, that could sing and all the women, they did that. Okay? But some years ago, back when our boys were younger, we were in Memphis, Tennessee. And Tammy, who's a little different, okay? And I mean that in a good way. See, Tammy's loved music ever since she was a little girl. And she loved Elvis, because her mama used to walk around the house singing Elvis songs, okay? And so we're in Memphis, and Tammy says, I want to go to Graceland. And I'm like, whatever. Let's go. Okay. I can hang out for a few hours. You know, as long as I got some shade and something to drink, I'm good. So we went to Graceland, and as we toured Graceland, you go through the house and you go through the grounds and you something changed for me. I learned some stuff about Elvis. I learned that Elvis was a good old Southern boy, just like me. I learned that Elvis loved his mama. I learned that Elvis was a very generous man who gave away millions and millions of dollars to those less fortunate everywhere he went. I learned that he had people in his life who did not have his best interest at heart. He was surrounded by unscrupulous people. And there is evidence. Now, I can't judge this man's heart. It's not my place to. But there is strong evidence that he may have trusted in Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. Here's my point. The more I learned about Elvis, the more I knew him, the more I kind of appreciated him. Does that make sense? So by the time I got to the back of the house where he's buried there on the estate. Now, I won't say I was an Elvis fan, but I was like, maybe this guy was more than just a fat guy in a jumpsuit. Maybe there was more to him. Here's my point, church, and feel free to write this down because this is from God, not me. Our feelings for someone are affected by how personally we know them. Let me say that again. Our feelings for someone are affected by how personally we know them. Let me apply that principle to your faith. The more we get to know Jesus here, the more we're going to love him here. Amen? Love the Lord your God with all your mind. I think that's why the Apostle Peter told us, grow in grace and in knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Peter says, get to know Jesus better. Get to know him, because if you give all of your mind to him, you're going to love him with all your heart. Because you will realize how wonderful, how great, how awesome he really is. Let me preach to you for just a minute. If church is the only place that you ever crack open a Bible, if church is the only time you hear about God, if church is the only time you spend with God, you're not loving him with all your mind. We should be learning more about God every day, gaining understanding, gaining discernment every day, getting closer to him every day. Too many of us, and I'm preaching to you, too many of us spend more time updating our Facebook page than we do reading a Bible page. Too many of us spend more time pursuing a dollar or our hobby than we spend pursuing him. What would happen if all of us at Mount Moriah Baptist Church loved God with all of our minds, made it our focus to pursue him, to go after him, and to know him better? It would change this church, amen, which in turn would change your community. What if all of God's churches did that? If we just loved God with all our mind. Let me ask you my question. Do you really love God? Do you really love him? Number four, and we'll go to the house. If you really love God, you will love him with all your strength. You'll love him with all your strength. There's an old saying, talk is cheap. Anybody can walk in here and go, I'm a Christian. I love God. I hear it all the time. Yeah, I love God, preacher. I love God. I love God. Most of us can talk the talk. We know how to pray. We know the words to the songs. We know when to stand up, when to sit down. We know how to do church. We know how to do all that stuff. Talk is cheap. Here's the thing. Do we walk the walk? Loving God with all your strength means that you're using your time, your talents, and your treasures to demonstrate your love for him. A lot of us say we love God, but our actions would say differently. A lot of people, like I say, walk in those doors and go, oh, well, I love God, I love God. But you're not doing anything to show your love for God. Well, I showed up for church, preacher. Isn't that enough? Quite frankly, no, it's not. The devil comes to church. Amen? Listen to this. True love requires action. True love. Man, did you hear me? Valentine's Day is Wednesday. True love requires action. Y'all ain't hearing this. Your wife is going to Wednesday. She's going to say, did you hear the preacher? I'm trying to help somebody here. And ladies, I'm talking to you too. True love requires action. I can tell my wife I love her all the time, which is important. I should. But I demonstrate my love for her. I love her with all my strength when there's an actual, visible, tangible effort involved. It's not just enough to say, honey, I love you, and then go on my way. It's nice to hear it, amen? But that's not enough. She needs more. I need more. You need more. When I pick up a broom and sweep the floor at my house, when I take out the trash, when I wash a dish, when I give her a gift for no reason, when I take time and really listen to her, now I'm loving her with all my strength. Somebody thinks I'm going somewhere with this. Takes a lot of strength to listen to my wife for a while. No. I'm kidding. Let's don't be like the old couple. You know, they've been married for years and years and years and years. And he was at the general store one day with his buddies. And the buddy says, how come you never talk about your wife or anything like that? And he says, she's the house doing her thing. Well, do you ever tell her you love her? I told her I loved her on the day we got married. If I changed my mind, I'd have told her. Gentlemen, some of you are that way. Your wife hasn't heard you say, I love you, I appreciate you, and so long. Do this. Wednesday. I'm trying to help somebody. Wednesday. Buy a flower. Do it on Tuesday, gentlemen, because there won't be none on Wednesday. Buy a flower. Just a rose. That's all it takes. A rose. On Wednesday, walk into the kitchen where she's at with the flower behind your back. Walk in there. Pull it out. Grab her. Give her a kiss. Look her in the eye and say, I love you. Then pick her up off the floor and do it again. That's loving your wife with all your strength. And wives, the same is vice versa. Amen? Amen? We're not always the bad guys. Are you loving God with all your strength? Are you serving Him? I know a lot of us got saved and we said, thank you, Jesus. Appreciate you. Thank you for dying for me. And then we went on and lived our lives. I got my ticket. I'm good. So we went on with our lives. Are you really serving Him? Are you loving Him with your strength? Are you loving Him with your time, your talents, your treasures? Are you doing it with your strength? Or is it all talk? Let me ask my question. Do you really love God? You know, church, when you and I got saved, we got all of God. Did you know that? We got all of Him. He's an all-in God. When you said, Lord, I'm a sinner, I need to be saved, I accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, He came down and He filled you with His Holy Spirit. He gifted you. He gave you eternal life. He gave you everything. He says, here, I am yours. Did He get all of you? Or are you still holding back? We got all of His love. Did we give Him all of our love? You know, I preach these sermons to myself before I get to preach them to you. And I was convicted because I can see areas in my life where I don't love God with all my heart, all my soul, all my mind, and all my strength. Have you ever had someone in your life who you never hear from until they need something? Anybody ever experienced that? You never hear from them until they need a favor, until they want something from you. Are we guilty of treating God like that, church? Are we? Let's be honest. Too many of us are like, Lord, I love you. I love you. Thank you for saving me. Thank you, Lord, for helping me. I don't have to go to hell. Thank you. And if I need you, Lord, I'll let you know. But in the meantime, if you don't mind, you just stay over there and I'll call you when I need you. Yeah. A bunch of us treat God that way. Well, church, please hear what I'm about to say, and I'm going to close. God isn't looking for a part-time relationship with you. He's not. He wants all of you. He wants all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. Michaela, would you come on down, please? I'm going to ask my question one more time. Do you really love God? Do you really love God? I hope this sermon has helped you to examine yourself as it has me. Do I really love God? Folks, church, brothers, sisters, I've got some work to do in my life. I tell people all the time, yeah, I love God. I'm the pastor. I love God. But there's too much I'm holding back from Him. I need to let Him have all of me. Anybody with me? Amen. I ask you to stand to your feet. Just close your eyes, bow your heads. If anybody needs to come to this altar today, would you come on down? Maybe you're like me. Maybe you've seen something in yourself today that you're uncomfortable with, that you need to deal with. Somebody needs to come down to the altar and say, Lord, you don't have all of me, but I want you to. Come down and take my heart, my soul, my mind, my strength. I want to dedicate it all to you today. Come on down. Maybe there's somebody here that's overwhelmed by life. You got too much going on. Come on down. Maybe you're here today and you need to rededicate your life. Come on down. Maybe you're here today and you don't know the Jesus I'm talking about. You've never accepted Him. Would you come on down? Whatever decision you need to make today, let the Lord have it. Maybe you're here today and you just need to praise God. You need to thank Him for the great things He's done for you. How He's blessed you, how He's moved in your family, what He's done. Come on down and just thank Him today. Lord Father, we love You so much. We're grateful, we're thankful for Your Son, Jesus Christ. The way You love us is phenomenal. It's a miracle. And we thank You for loving us. Lord, I pray that from this day forward, we would make it our goal to love You with all that we are, to help us to be who we need to be. Father, we love You so much. I pray for every person in here today. I pray for every person watching online. Just help us, Father. Help us. We love You, Lord. We love You. But let our love be real. Let it be genuine and let it be all that we are. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. And everyone said, Amen. Amen. Church, thank you for being here today. I hope God's Holy Spirit spoke to you.